Is it really like, really?
Well, good morning. I think I'm not the only one. I think time change is so hard. I apologize. I'm slow to adapt. I blame being a new dad. But in fairness, I blame everything on being a new dad. Henry, what do I need to do here? There it is. There it is. I'm going to stand here, if that's okay with everybody. Welcome. Excuse, pardon your pastor and his sleep deprivation and slowness to adapt. We are glad you are here. This is the day the Lord has made, and Sunday it's time to worship. And so we're glad to have you, whether you're a visitor with us or whether you've been here for decades. It's good to be in God's house and to worship God. Before we begin our worship service, I do just want to call your attention to a few things. First off, thank you. For those of you who stayed after last week, we had our forum, as we call it, as we considered this potential partnership with UMC Foods. We wanted to hear from you, and we did. And I just want to say thank you. For those of you who were here, offered your questions and concerns, it actually clarified a lot for those of us who have been looking at this, as to what we need to make sure we know and what we need to make sure we address as we consider moving forward. And so we did spend this last week. We took all of your questions from both services, and we spent a lot of time. We called the director of the UMC Foods, the Northern Kentucky DS, a few pastors, everyone we needed to basically to get the answers to the questions and concerns that you raised. And we compiled those. They're on the Welcome Center outside the sanctuary. You can pick up a copy just so that you know what we now know if you've been tracking with us through this. And that is the sheet that our church council will use this Thursday when they meet. Again, our commitment was that we would walk through and make sure every one of those has been addressed before we will even consider moving forward with this. And so they'll deliberate on that on Thursday. Even after that, it's not 100%. We can't back out commitment quite yet, but it's the next step forward. Whichever way that goes, of course, we'll keep you updated as we move through this process. So thank you for your involvement. Looking ahead, we got a lot going on. This is kind of the calm before the storm this week. Holy Week is coming, not this week, but next week. We're moving into the holiest of holy weeks, moving into the holiest of holy days on Easter. And so we want to make sure you're prepared. And to start that off, next Sunday, which is Palm Sunday, we will worship here in the sanctuary, but not at 11. Hear me say that. Not at 11. We are combining our services. We do this every so often just to celebrate that we are one church, not two separate churches meeting in two separate places in the same building. We are one First United Methodist Church of Somerset. And so next Sunday at 10:30, we will be here in the sanctuary to have a combined worship for Palm Sunday. And so I invite you to be there. If you're a little bit late, that's okay. We know that happens to people. If you show up at 11, just come on in. We're not going to glare at you. I promise. We know that happens. But write it on your calendar. Set your alarms. Whatever you got to do. You'll be here at 10:30 next Sunday here in the sanctuary for Palm Sunday. As part of that, after the worship is over, we're going to head downstairs to the Lower Fellowship Hall and have a meal together. It's a potluck meal, so I invite you to bring something, side dish. Casseroles are big. We're big on casseroles in the Methodist Church. But whatever works for you, to bring something to the meal afterwards. And as part of that, if you look in your bulletin, it's the insert with all the eggs on top of it. That kind of tells you what's going on. I love this idea. Our children's ministry, instead of doing an Easter egg hunt where all our kids get stuff, they're actually going to do an unexpected blessing. Unexpected? You get it? Thank you. Where they will be putting eggs together and then delivering them out to people who maybe can't get out of their homes or just very can't get out often. And so we're going to, instead of our kids being blessed with candy, they're going to be a blessing. And I love that. That, to me, is what it means to be a disciple and follower of Jesus. And so we want to help them with that. And so many of you have donated already. We still do need candy to fill those eggs with. And we need names and addresses. If there's anyone, and it doesn't have to be a member of this church, a friend or family member of yours, it does have to be local, who could you, right?
Yes.
Okay. Who needs a blessing in that sense, turn that in, and you can write that down, turn it in the offering plate. You can turn that into Vicki or email our church office, whatever you want to do. Let us know who we need to get out to, and we would love to do that with them. And then you can help us kind of put those together that day as well. And so we invite you next Sunday, 10:30 here in the sanctuary, with a meal to follow, just to kind of kick off Holy Week. And so participate in that as you can. And the last thing today, we're going to, in addition to our regular offering, we're going to invite you to give to something else as well. This isn't one of our big UMC offerings. I know we just had Encore last week. But next week, on Holy Week, on Thursday, we are hosting the lunch service. I love this tradition. I've not gotten to live it here yet, but my understanding, they tell me, is that every Holy Week, the churches in our neighborhood work together, which is pretty fantastic, I gotta say. And so every day of Holy Week at noon, there is a service at different churches, and that's on the insert in the bulletin as well. Thursdays is here. And so we'll have the service, we'll take care of that, no worries. But there's a lunch afterward, and that's where we need your help. Because we want to welcome our brothers and sisters in the faith from all around Somerset into our home here at church. We don't provide them with lunch as part of that, but we need your help to do that. And so if you can contribute to that lunch, you can either on a check just write that this is for Thursday lunch or Holy Week lunch, whatever you want to call it. Or if it's a cash offering, put it in one of the envelopes in your pew and just write the same thing on that. We're taking that against that those who come into our church feel welcome and feel loved. We're also doing that because there is an offering taken that day, but we don't want it to go to that. We want to actually send it to PERM, the Pulaski Emergency Relief Ministry. And so we don't want people who come to have to give to themselves. We want them to be able to give to someone else who is in need. And so we want to take care of everything for them. And so when it comes time for our offering, I'll invite you to give to that if you're able to. And I appreciate that. But with all that being said, with all that's in front of us and ahead of us, today is still Sunday. It's the day the Lord was made, and we're here to worship. As we prepare to do that, I invite you, would you stand, greet the people around you in the name and in the love of Christ.
The way of creation and
Christians, join us in.
Thank you.
to bow with me as we pray. Almighty God, it is sweet to trust in you. It is good and it is a delight. For we know, God, that you are an amazing God. You are awesome and holy. You're so far beyond us, we cannot comprehend you. We cannot even begin to hope to comprehend you. And yet, God, at the same time, you love us better and fuller than anyone we have ever known. That you are a God of love. You are a God of all peace.
Yes.
We celebrate today that as we come before you in this place, we are not alone. That you are a God, not just of Methodists in Somerset. That you're a God of all traditions. You're a God of Baptists, Pentecostals, Presbyterians, and Christians with no name at all, who just call themselves followers of Jesus. Well, we thank you, too, that you are a God, not just of people in Somerset or America, but people around the world. We praise you that you are being praised this morning, this day, in every language that exists on the planet. You are a God all your people. And so God, as we come before you with our prayers this morning, we offer them as one small part of your grand diverse people. But you are great and holy and amazing God, and we thank you for all that you have done throughout history and all you are doing now here in this place, yes, but also around the world. We thank you for miracles that we will never hear. We thank you for people who come to faith in you, whose names we will never know. We thank you for disciples that are being made, whose impact in your planet will never reach our ears. Thank you, Lord, that you are bigger than us, that your church is bigger than us, and that your faith, this faith, is bigger than us. And yet, too, we know, Almighty God, that we are no less important for all that. Not because we have done anything special or are anything special, but because we're your children. You love us, and you are special. So, God, we ask that here in this place, you would move. Your spirit would dwell among us, it would move through. That we would be transformed by its power. That it, through us, would transform this community, this county, this state, this nation, and this world. We pray, God, that while we are not alone among your people, we would stand equal with them in doing your work. And so, God, as we offer a portion of what you have given us as our tithes and our offerings, we pray that it would go to that very work. That it would be used to expand your kingdom. That through it, the lost would be saved. The sinner would be forgiven. That people would be brought, Lord, into your community and your salvation. Lord, bless these tithes and this offering. Bless our works of service that we offer with the same prayer. Bless all that we do in this church, but also outside of this church. Lord, we offer you more than our offering today. We offer you ourselves. Everything that we are, mind, heart, body, and soul, Lord, are yours. You gave them to us, and we give them back. For you to use according to your will, within your mission, for your creation and your people. Pray this. We pray all things in your name. As we pray the prayer our Lord taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. I'm going to invite all our children to follow Miss Vicky out to Children's Church, and I'm going to invite the rest of you to pull out your Bibles if you have them. I have a confession to make. I got my Bible verse wrong today. The verses are right, but we're not in Luke's Gospel, we're in John. So I invite you to turn to John's Gospel, the 19th chapter, verse 28, or you can just listen. But either way, hear now the word of God. After this, when Jesus knew that all was now finished, he said, in order to fulfill the scripture, I'm thirsty. A jar full of sour wine was standing there. They put a sponge full of the wine on a branch of hyssop and held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the wine, he said, it is finished. Then he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
So I want you all to know that at some point in this message, I will say that Jesus is like the bicep of Arnold Schwarzenegger. And at that point, you will know what that means. And I hope most, if not all of you, will agree with me. So you got that to look forward to. But we can't start with that. We have to start with our scripture. We have to start with, let me reemphasize again, in John's Gospel, not Luke's. And as far as John's Gospel is concerned, the words you just heard Christ speak, the same words you heard our choir sing, they are Jesus' final words before he died. Now, speaking of Luke, it's worth mentioning that Luke, in his Gospel, gives a slightly different account of Jesus' very last words, and we're going to hear that next week. But I'm not really interested in trying to determine which gospel writer got Jesus' very last words correct. To me, that just misses the whole point both gospel writers are trying to make here. As far as I'm concerned, Jesus said everything that the gospels say he did, and each and every word he spoke from that cross, amen, from the first one to whichever one is last, each one is worth stopping and worth listening to. Because remember what we said at the beginning. For Jesus, given where he is, given what he suffered, every word he speaks in these moments is absolute agony. Every word he says in these hours, we have to assume then, it is spoken because it is absolutely essential that people hear it, that we hear it, and that we hear it from this man, in this hour, from this cross. Including the words you just heard, spoken from John's Gospel. In Greek, the phrase is one word. The telestai. I'm not saying that just to show off my Greek. It's not that great. But I just want you to remember that every English Bible we have, including yours, and that goes for whichever version you own, every English Bible we have is a translation. And sometimes translating is really hard to do. Like here, for instance. See, to telestai, it's a really hard word to translate into English. It is finished is probably the most common way we translate it. Probably most of your Bibles have that. But even that misses the mark just a little bit. We just don't have an English word that quite has the fullness of this Greek one. And so some other translations say it is accomplished. Or still others might say something to the effect of its purpose has been fulfilled. To maybe dig at this a little bit, it's the kind of thing you would say when you're set to graduate high school or college and finally get that diploma, right? Finally, it is finished. My classroom days are done. When I got my seminary degree, I went on a little bit longer than that, but you get the idea. At last, it's over. Or maybe it's a thing you would say on moving day, right? You've taken all the boxes and the furniture, put it on the truck, driven for however long to the new place, and spent most of the day unloading everything, putting it where you thought it goes, but realizing that the room's not quite the size you thought it was, and having to rearrange a little bit and turn furniture sideways, and then finally, at the end of the day, at least in a fine place, and you can collapse on the couch or on the mattress on the floor, and you say, thank goodness, it's completed. I moved in. Or, and this is based on some recent experience as well, I think that if new mothers were capable of speech after hours of labor, they might say it right after the baby's born. It is done! In sign language, it's worth noting the sign for this word would probably be this. Right? Finish. Finish. It's kind of like, I don't know if any of you watch the reality show Chopped. It's one of the few reality shows I actually tend to watch occasionally. It's like when the host says, time's up, contestants, right? And they prepared their meal, and they all do this. I don't know if they're told to be dramatic about it, but they always are. They throw their hands way up over their head and take like 3 steps back. All right. It's like, Evan, I'm not touching it anymore because it's done. It's complete. Now it goes before the judges. That's the kind of word that this is. To tell us that is finished. All that begs the question, though, what is it? If it is finished, what is it? And Jesus does not explicitly say. I mean, I recognize Jesus, that speaking is incredibly painful at this point, but don't you think Jesus could have added a couple words here just to spell out what exactly is finished? It's kind of an important detail, don't you think? He could have taken just a few moments to help us out. Well, no. No, he didn't. Because he didn't have to. Because we don't actually need that help. Of course we don't. First off, remember, everything he has said while being on this cross up to this point has given us a few really good hints. And if you've been with us throughout this series, you probably can guess a little bit about what this gets to. But each word, each phrase, hints at what Jesus set out to accomplish. If you remember, this started a few weeks ago at the very beginning of Lent, with that amazing and deeply profound phrase, Father, forgive them. It showed that Jesus came not to offer forgiveness, which is just forgetting and bypassing, but a forgiveness that is actually transformative. That leaves the one who needs forgiveness and the one who offers it both completely changed by the power of God's Spirit. That's him. After that, we moved forward and we heard those great lines, behold your son, behold your mother. And we realized that Jesus came to make a family. A family based on something greater even than blood relation. Himself and his Spirit. And we kept moving and then came that phrase, today you will be with me in paradise, said to a bandit who had absolutely no understanding of who Jesus was, what he came to do, but just knew his own need and saw in Jesus the answer. And showed that Jesus came so that our past no longer had to dictate our future. Because Jesus died as he lived. That was a hint for us too. And then we roll on into last week and finally that incredible, agonizing, my God, why have you forsaken? Showing that Jesus knows our agony, knows our feelings of abandonment and loneliness. Showing that Jesus came to live our life, endure our pain, and die our death so that, spoiler here, when he's ready, we can then live his life, experience his joy, and find brand new life and joy and love within him. More about that in the coming weeks, all right? And again, thank you, Daniel, for your help in all of that. If you've been here, you've heard it. All of that hints, gives us a glimpse, shows us one side of what it is. The work Jesus is now declaring complete. But even if you weren't here, even if you missed all of that and weren't paying attention to the summary I just gave you, that's okay too, because that's not all we have to go on. I mean, even without those hints, we would still have a really good idea of what Jesus is referring to, because we know what Jesus spent his life doing. I mean, come on. Would you honestly ask a new mother what she means when she says, "I did it"? No, you would not. Would you ask a college graduate on graduation day what they mean by "it is finished"? No, you would not. Because you don't need to. Because it's obvious. If you look at what each person had been doing in the hours, days, or years leading up to that moment, you would know. And so no, we do not need Jesus to spell out exactly what it is. We just have to look at his life. Look at what he's been doing in the years leading up to this moment. And if we do that, we get a whole lot of it. In fact, Jesus himself talks about what that work is. He uses several different phrases for it. In one part, he says that he's here to proclaim God's kingdom. In another part, he says that he's here to seek out and save the lost. In still another part, he says he's here to save sinners. At the very beginning of his ministry, when he went to his hometown and preached in his synagogue, he said that he's here to bring good news to the poor, release to the captives, recovery of sight to the blind, and to let the oppressed go free. Amen. All of that and more is what we have. These hints aren't subtle. But if we were to take all of that and put it together, to just one concise phrase, I think maybe the best way to say what that work is to say that Jesus came to fix the broken relationship between God and God's people.
Yes, sir.
I think everything Jesus did, from his birth in Bethlehem to even now this moment, his death, everything was done to accomplish, complete, finish, whatever word you want to use, that singular purpose. To fix the relationship between God and God's people. Now, Jesus did that in a lot of ways. He devoted his whole life to it.
Yeah.
And as we move closer to Holy Week, and as we move into the season after, we're going to be unpacking some of how Jesus did that. And it's one of those things, it's a mystery. Not in that you can't understand anything about it. No, what a mystery is that you're never going to understand everything. But still, we'll try. We'll dive into it in a packet, but today I'd just like to keep it simple, if that's okay. Take it down to the bare minimum, lowest shelf. One way of many that Jesus fixed our broken relationship with God was by showing us what God looked like, what we were meant to look like, by showing us what love looked like. And that's pretty simple, isn't it? Oh, how necessary it was. We needed that. It's so simple, but we didn't have it. We desperately, desperately needed it. I don't know if you ever thought of it, but there's a rule that governs all of our lives as human beings. We tend to become what we focus on. Where we direct our eyes, we tend to look like that at the end. And this is where Arnold Schwarzenegger's bicep comes in. I told you we'd get here. I promised it to you, so here it is. The gym I go to is Club Fit. It's kind of down 27 ways. I don't go as often as I used to, getting new dad. But I still try and go at least twice a week. And just so you know, they didn't ask me to mention them today. They didn't offer me an endorsement. Actually, as you're about to find out, they might be hesitant to. Because, and I say that because While I do love my gym, it has what I need, I love going, there are a few details I would probably change if I were in charge. How do you feel about my gym? Probably the way you feel about your church. We love it, but there are a few things we would change if we were in charge. I know we feel that way. I feel that way too down there. And just for instance, as an example, if you walk into the main area, the first thing you will see on a big giant plaster wall is a gigantic mural of Arnold Schwarzenegger. We're talking the kind of mid-late 80s, super fit, bodybuilding Arnold Schwarzenegger, arms lifted up, every muscle flexed, and totally ripped version, all right? That Arnold Schwarzenegger, you can't miss it. You walk in, it is ginormous, okay? And it is located in such a way that when I go to do a particular exercise on a bench, and particularly if I incline it, you know, to do incline press like you do, when I do that, I am forced to stare directly into a ginormous bicep of Arnold Schwarzenegger, which, again, would not be my first choice when it comes to exercise ambiance. I think it would be fair to say. But while I may not prefer it, I gotta admit, as I lie there, staring into the muscle fibers of that massive bicep, particularly as I then see my comparison quite puny arm, my peripheral vision, I do tend to lift a little harder in that moment. I tend to push a little harder, work a little harder, try to do a little more weight. Because while I will never be ripped like Arnold, we become what we focus on. It's big, it's intimidating, I might never be like it, but when I'm forced to stare at it, I try and become a little more like it. We become what we focus on. And that's how Jesus is just like Arnold Schwarzenegger's bicep. I mean, picture it. Let's do a quick mental exercise here. Close your eyes. Stop looking at me. Close your eyes. I want you to picture the perfect life for just a second. Picture it. Let your imagination soar across all the possibilities, all the resources in the world at your disposal, every job yours for the taking or the turning down, every person in the world ready to be your friend or a husband or wife or whatever you want. Picture the perfect life. All right, you can open your eyes. Now, I don't know what just flashed through your brain right then, but I imagine the first thing was not poverty, servanthood, suffering, and death. That's just my guess. It wasn't for me. I mean, I don't want to be dictator of the universe or anything like that, but perfect life, I'd at least take, I don't know, a beach house in Spain, something like that. That's the first thought I go to. I might make it better later, but that's not where I go first. Again, I can't speak for you, but I'm not naturally predisposed to thinking that a life full of conflict, betrayal, persecution, and hunger, all of which culminates in my murder, all for the sake of other people instead of myself, is the life for me. Living my best self does not involve 40 days of fasting, is all I'm trying to say. Now, the way I go with this, and if you're like me, maybe you took a similar approach, I probably take one person, probably a famous person, I take their life, and then I try and make a collage, I'll draw from others, and try and make a mismatch, a hodgepodge into the perfect life. Like I would, my natural inclination, I don't know, let's start with the general lifestyle of Selena Gomez, and then add to that the mental brilliance of the now sadly late Stephen Hawking. That'd be good. And yeah, let's take that bicep from the Arnold and every, you know, all the other muscles and add that onto it too. And at that point, I'm pretty well along the road to the perfect life. I mean, your people can be different from my people, but the point remains. We become what we focus on. And when it comes to our life, We are naturally predisposed to focus on people who live lives very different from the life Jesus led. And that's part, a simple part, but a profoundly important part of what Jesus did on that cross. At that moment, Jesus could say that he had lived a perfect life from birth to death. And humanity had never seen it before. We'd never seen it before. Do you realize that? We've never seen what it should look like. Everyone had fallen short. Even if we weren't being superficial and pleasure-seeking, like I've kind of acted like in the last few minutes, even if we were trying to be morally good, we still couldn't pull it off. If you read your Old Testament, it's full of heroes that the people of Israel looked up to, trying to find that perfect life. They looked to Abraham, who followed what God called, but even he was shy and was afraid and hid when people came against him. They didn't trust in his God. They held up Samson, the strong with the long hair, right? Beating the Philistines. There's always that mass murder part of his life. Ignore that part. The closest they could get was King David, right? The best king. Most faithful person, the man after God's own heart. There's just that whole adultery and conspiracy to commit murder part. You kind of have to. No one had done it. And so we were left wondering what parts are good, what parts do we need to let go of. If there's not one thing we can look at, we're going to debate it, we're going to get caught up in the discussion, and we're going to lose focus. We simply did not know what our lives were supposed to look like, what we were supposed to look like. No one had showed us, no one could show us until now. Until Jesus. Because then Jesus finished it. His life. And now we knew. Now we knew what it looked like. Perfectly. Now we have someone we can look to. Even now we have it. As we imperfect people struggle through this imperfect world, there is a perfect beacon shining to us, guiding us along the way.
Yeah.
Jesus, and I'll stand on this. Jesus is like Arnold Schwarzenegger's bicep. As we struggle to lift the weight, as we struggle to live the perfect life, his example stays before us. It's intimidating. Oh, yes, it is. Perfection's intimidating. It's overwhelming at times. It takes up our vision. It's really big. We need it to be. Because we're easily distracted. When our eyes stay on it, so we look to it. By the power of the Holy Spirit, we work a little harder. We lift a little harder. We love a little better. We're a little humbler. We work for God's mission instead of ours. It's so simple. So simple. It is absolutely essential. We cannot have any hope of living the life to which we were called if we don't have something to look toward.
That's right.
I just want to add one more thing to this. And to point out that it's not just us. It's not just for us. It doesn't just apply to us. I recognize we Christians, we the church, we are Jesus' physical presence in the world now. I get that. And there's a responsibility there we have to take seriously. But on the same time, let's admit, we fall short of that. Even when we try, we still tend to fall short. We don't always try. We're imperfect people. If people look to us to see Jesus, they will be disappointed. Hopefully not often. Hopefully not too much. But they will. Let's own that. Let's admit that. And if it were all on us, that would be devastating. It's devastating to me when I fall short. When someone looked to me needing to see love or mercy or grace or something and I let them down, And for all to me, I call to despair over. But if I have nothing else, if we as a church have nothing else, even when we are broken, when we fall short, and when we are hurtful, we can still point somewhere else. We can say, we try to be the body. But you gotta look over there. We don't have to be perfect to bring others to Jesus. We just always have to point.
That's good.
We have to say, yeah, I know, I've got problems, I don't do it right, but you know what? With God's help, with God's Spirit, I'm trying. I don't always hit the mark, I miss it way more than I want, but I know where the mark is. You know how I know? It's right there.
Yeah.
The bullseye is right there. I know exactly where it is, I know exactly what it looks like. I can read it, I can see it. I know how it ended. It ended in love. That was willing to give up everything and suffer everything for us, even though we didn't deserve it. I know what the perfect life looks like because I've seen the cross, the man who hangs on it. That's the beat. That's the light shining in the darkness. Again, we still need help. We still need the Spirit of God within us, but at least we know where to look. So we know where to aim. We know we missed the mark because we know where the bullseye is. So simple. But we need it. And now it's been finished. Thanks be to God. Let's pray. My God, we so often fall short. But it's thanks to your Son's example that we know that. For now we've seen it. But thank you for the gift of your Son's life, his death, and the resurrection that we anticipate. Thank you that we who were lost now have a light to see by. Lord, guide us with that light. By your Spirit, direct us and strengthen us to walk in that light. That we might more and more, by your Spirit, become your people. That more and more, we might look like you. So that the world might see you through us. Lord, when we fall short, give us the humility to point beyond ourselves to your Son. To offer him up. The perfect life that he completed for all of us. In your name we pray. Amen. Our closing hymn can be found in your bulletins. I invite you to stand and join me in singing. It's finished. With a sigh of God.
Oh,
fall, you may miss the mark, but it's only because you know where the light is shining. The perfect life has been lived by God's Spirit that lies before us. Go following in that light. Go pointing others to that light. By your life and by your example, but also too with words and deeds. So they know where to look. And go as you always do go. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.